Good morning. Glad to see you here today. Glad you braved the weather and came out this morning. I hope you enjoyed your Christmas. I know it was a good time for me and my family. Hopefully it was for you as well. We had about 50 people at our New Year's Eve service last week, so it was pretty awesome. Thank you to everyone involved in putting that together who participated either on the stage or behind the scenes. Appreciate all that you do. Now today, of course, is New Year's Eve, the last day of 2017. And so at New Year's, you know, as we come to the end of a year, get ready to start a new year, we tend to all do two things, and that's we reflect and we resolve, right? We kind of become reflective on the past year, maybe a bit nostalgic, maybe a bit regretful, right? Whatever the case is, we just kind of become reflective on the past year, and then we begin to make our resolutions for the new year, kind of our plans and our goals. If it was a bad year, we want to make this next year better. If it was a good year, we want to go above and beyond, right? And so that's kind of usually the mood of people this time of year, reflecting and resolving. And the reason for this is the new year, of course, is it's an opportunity for a new beginning, right? It's kind of, we got this sense of it's a new year. It's kind of a fresh start. It's an opportunity to wipe 2017 away, kind of start new and fresh. And the reality is that you see this idea even all throughout the Bible, this idea of new beginnings, of fresh starts. In fact, we see that our God is a God of new beginnings, right? God loves new beginnings. God loves fresh starts. He's never done with us. He's never finished. He always has new days for us. And so just a few examples of this I'm going to run through real quick. We see in Isaiah 43, verse 19, God says, "Behold, I am doing a new thing." Revelation 21, verse 5 says, "And he who was seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I am making all things new.'" Ezekiel 36, verse 26 says, "And I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you." And then 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is passed away. Behold, the new has come." Now, these are just a few examples of many that I could keep going through. Just this idea, it's all throughout the Bible, of new beginnings and fresh starts. Our God is a God of new beginnings. And if you ever feel like you've come to the end, it's really never the end with God. It's always an opportunity to start new and fresh. And we see that God has woven into the very fabric of creation these rhythms of new beginnings. Right, so in a sense, time is kind of this linear progression, right? It just continually just moves forward. But God has built, even within the rhythms of time, this kind of these cycles of fresh starts and new beginnings. Right, every single day we have a restart. Right, every 24 hours the sun sets and then it rises again. We wake up when the sun rises, we go to sleep when the sun sets, and we sleep and then we do it all over again, right? It's just kind of woven into the very fabric of our existence, these rhythms of new beginnings. We cycle through every 24 hours a new day. Right? We have an opportunity to reset and to recharge and to start fresh and new. We've got every year. And that's what we're celebrating today and tomorrow. We're celebrating this new year, right? That a year has come and gone. The earth has revolved around the sun once again. It's this rhythm of new beginnings that's woven into the very fabric of our existence. And then, of course, you've got the seasons. Each year, the earth just goes through these seasons of spring and summer and fall and winter, and it cycles back through. I mean, it's in the very fabric of who we are, these rhythms of new beginnings. Every day, every week, every month, every year, we go through these cycles of fresh starts and new beginnings. And so, as we come to the end of another year, and we're getting ready to enter into a new year, and we're all kind of in this mood of whether it's nostalgia or whether it's regretfulness or whether whatever kind of mood you're in, you're just kind of reflecting on the past year, getting ready to enter into the new year, making your resolutions. I want us to consider that in order to enter into a new beginning, any new beginning, any new opportunity, any new season that God might have for us, we must reflect and resolve. And so that's what I want us to consider this morning. I'm not going to go too terribly long today. I just want to consider this, and then we'll be on our way. So the first thing we must do, if we want to enter into new beginnings and fresh starts, new opportunities, new seasons, we need to reflect on the past. The number one command, and I've said this before, but the number one command in the Bible is not thou shalt or thou shalt not. But the number one repeated command throughout Scripture is simply to remember. God constantly is telling us to remember. God wants us to remember the past, especially what He has done for us and on our behalf. Right? God on repeat, He commands us to remember. So let me just give you a few examples. I'll run through these real quick as well. Isaiah 46, verse 9 says, "Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me." Deuteronomy 8, verse 2, it says, "And you shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness." 1 Chronicles 16, 12 says, "Remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and the judgments he uttered." 2 Timothy 2, 8 says, "Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel." And then Luke 22, verse 19, Jesus says, "And he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" On repeat throughout the Bible, the number one command in Scripture is to remember. We are to reflect on the past and to remember who our God is and what he has done for us, because we are a forgetful people. Right, we just tend to forget, and God tells us on repeat, remember, don't forget what I've done for you, don't forget who I am, don't forget how far I've brought you, what I've done in your life up to this point. Remember. And so why should we remember the past? Why is this important to remember the past, and especially to remember what God's done for us? Well, three things. Number one, the past teaches us. The past is a great teacher, right? We tend to learn from the past, especially past mistakes and failures, right? So if we remember the past can be a great teacher that we can learn from. And then secondly, the past has a way of motivating us, right? Right? If we reflect on the past, we remember the past, we remember what God's done for us, we remember what we've been through, it has a way of motivating us for the future. So whether your past is painful or whether your past is great, it has a way of motivating us into the future. And then thirdly, the past encourages us. If we will allow it, the past can encourage us. Now, the past can certainly discourage us. Right? If we've had a rough past, if there's some things that's happened that maybe we're regretful of or we wish would have gone differently, the past can certainly discourage us. But if we will allow it, the past can encourage us to press on, to move forward, to enter into the new that God has for us. And so I want to give three ways that we can remember the past. As we come to the end of the year, right, New Year's Eve, we're going into 2018, and we're kind of reflecting on the past. I want to give three quick ways that we can remember the past. The first is to simply keep records, right? And whatever that might look for you, whether you keep a diary or a journal, that's a great way of doing it so that you could go back and see written accounts from your own hands of what God has done, what you've been through, what has happened in the past. Keep records, right? I've heard of people writing down memories and putting them in a jar so that they could just randomly pull things out and just remember and reflect on the past. So keep records. Because again, we're a forgetful people. And the reality is that most of your life will fly by and you're going to forget the majority of it. So it's a good idea to get into a habit of just keeping some sort of record of the past so that you can remember it, so that you can look back on and see even documentation of this is what's happened. So keep records. And then secondly, celebrate victories. Right? Celebrate the victories in your life. Celebrate what God's done for you. Celebrate the triumphs that you've experienced. It's good to celebrate. Take time to celebrate those victories in the past. If you're kind of reflecting on 2017 and there's been some awesome moments, some great memories, celebrate those. Take time to celebrate and acknowledge those victories. But then also, thirdly, celebrate failures. When I was first writing out this message, in my notes, I had to grieve or mourn failures, but I changed it to celebrate failures because I remembered a story about Henry Ford, who, when he was still alive, their company, anytime they experienced failure, anytime in their company, anytime Ford experienced failure, they would gather everyone together in the company and they would throw a big party to celebrate that failure. So they didn't just celebrate their victories, they celebrated their failures, and the reason is because they learned, this doesn't work, now we can move on and figure out what does, right? And I thought, how awesome is that, that culture of, we're going to not only celebrate our victories, we're going to celebrate our failures, because we can learn from it, we can figure out, okay, this doesn't work, let's try something different, we can learn what does work, right? It can teach us, it can motivate and encourage us. Right, so how awesome is that? So don't just celebrate your victory, celebrate the failures. And so if you've had some failures this last year, some things maybe you're ashamed of, you regret, some things that you wish could have gone differently, celebrate those. Just take a moment in the next day or two, this next week, just celebrate. Say, you know what? That was terrible. I shouldn't have done that. I wish that could have gone differently, but I can learn from it. I know what doesn't work. I can move on, right? Celebrate your victories and your failures. And so if we want to enter into new beginnings and new seasons and opportunities, we need to reflect on the past. And then secondly, we need to resolve for the future. Now the word resolve means to decide firmly on a course of action. And so if you want to enter into new seasons and opportunities that God might have for you this next year, you need to make the decisions and make the necessary steps in order to take. Right? So God might open new doors for you, but you ultimately are the one that have to walk through them. Right? God might open new doors and opportunities, but it's ultimately up to you whether you're going to take the necessary steps to walk through that open door, to leave the past behind and walk into whatever new opportunities and seasons God might have for you. So we don't just reflect on the past and remember the past, but we also resolve for the future. We plan ahead. We make our plans. We kind of decide, this is the course of action that I believe God wants me to take, and we take the necessary steps to walk into the open doors that God has. And so how do we resolve or plan for the future? Well, two things. Number one, we hold the future with open hands. We hold the future with open hands. The Bible says this, Proverbs 16, verse 9, that the heart of man plans his way, but the Lord establishes his steps. And then James chapter 4, verse 13 through 15 says, come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go into such and such a town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit. Yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. Now, we talked about this back in our James series a couple of months ago, right? That ultimately none of us are guaranteed tomorrow, right? We have no idea what tomorrow will bring, much less this very afternoon. Right? We just have no way of knowing. We are limited people, and yet we are instructed to make our plans, right? Make our plans, make our schedules, go about our lives. But if you remember what we talked about when we looked at this passage in detail a couple of months ago, we do it all with the asterisk that says, if the Lord wills, right? So we make our plans and we live our lives to the fullest, but we do it all with open hands. We hold the future with open hands because ultimately we have no idea what tomorrow will bring. No one is guaranteed tomorrow. And what happens when life doesn't go as planned, which is all the time, right? So what happens when you make your plans and you set your schedules and you've got your life goals and your resolutions for the new year and it doesn't go according to plan? Well, if you hold your future with clenched hands saying this is what's going to happen, then inevitably when those plans don't go according to plan, you become discouraged, you become frustrated, right, with yourself, with God. Right? And this is why we are to hold the future with open hands so that we know that when life doesn't go according to plan, it's okay. Right? We can trust that God knows what he's doing. Right? We do it all with the asterisk that says, if the Lord wills. We hold the future with open hands. And then number two, we let go of the past with open hearts. So we don't just hold the future with open hands, but we let go of the past with open hearts. This is what the Bible says, Isaiah 43, verse 18 and 19. Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. So we can't move into the new, whatever that is, new opportunities, seasons, you know, open doors, whatever it is, we can't enter into the new unless we let go of the old. Right? And so it is your past, whatever that might be, this last year, maybe the last decade, maybe just your entire life, is the past holding you back from entering into what God has for you in the future? So even if your past is good, right? Even if you look back and you've had an awesome past, that can hold you back. You could just end up like Uncle Rico, right? You know what I'm saying? Uncle Rico from Napoleon Dynamite, right? Where you're just living your glory days, right? I'm back in high school. I was awesome, right? And you're just kind of, you're stuck in the past living these nostalgic glory days. So even your good past can hold you back. Or maybe your past is filled with regret and shame, and that's holding you back because you're not able to let that go. Right? And so we need to let go of the past. We reflect on the past. We remember the past. We learn from it. We celebrate our victories. But ultimately, we let the past go. We leave it in the past, and we move on so that we can enter into whatever God has for us next. Paul says this, Philippians chapter 3, verse 13 and 14. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Now, I want to wrap up with this. How do we let go of the past? How do we begin to let go of what's happened in the past? Well, ultimately, we have to learn to forgive. That I talked about this last year around this time. I did a sermon called New Year's Absolutions. Because at New Year's, we make our New Year's resolutions. But what I talked about is it might be good to make New Year's absolutions where we absolve the past. Where we absolve and forgive and let go of whatever's happened in the past so that we can move into the future. And so we need to forgive others. Right, so if you've got people in your life, maybe this last year that's hurt you, that's let you down, that's failed you, right? Forgive others so that you can move on. And then secondly, forgive yourself. Right, this is something we often don't think about, but we don't just forgive others. We need to forgive ourselves, especially if you've failed, if you've let yourself down, right? Forgive yourself. And ultimately, we need to receive the forgiveness of God. Because we can't forgive others and we can't forgive ourselves fully unless we received the forgiveness that God has for us. Receive God's forgiveness. The Bible says this, Lamentations 3, verse 22 and 23. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I love this verse, right? That the mercies of God are new every morning. So what I love about this is it paints this idea that it doesn't matter how much mercies you use up in one day. Right? Let's just say you had a terrible day, right? And you just feel like you drained the mercies of God. Right? The Bible tells us that his mercies are new every morning. That when the sun rises, He has fresh mercy for you. Right? You can never drain the mercies of God. They are new and fresh every single morning. Right? Every day we have a new beginning and a fresh start. Every day God has new mercies for us. His forgiveness, his mercy, his grace is new every morning. And this is good news we can celebrate as we come to an end of this year. Whatever this year had for you, maybe it was an awesome year for you. That's amazing. Celebrate that and press on to what God has for you this year. But maybe it was a rough year for you, right? Maybe you made some mistakes or some things happened or you've got some shame and regret or disappointment or frustration, whatever it is. Receive the forgiveness of God. Receive his fresh mercies he has. Absolve the past, right? Let the past go and move into the new season that God has for you. Whatever God might have for us in 2018, whatever he has in store, only God knows, right? We have no idea what tomorrow will bring. But whatever God has for us, let's enter into the new. Let's let 2017 go, enter into 2018 with open hearts, open lives, open hands, and receive whatever God might have. Let's pray. Jesus, I thank you that you are a God of new beginning, that your mercies are new every morning, that you have new opportunities, new seasons, new open doors for us. And I pray that we're able to, as we reflect on the past and we remember the past, ultimately we're able to let the past go. Forgive those who've hurt us, forgive ourselves, so that we can move into whatever you have for us next in our lives. We don't want to live in the glory days of old. We don't want to dwell in our regret and shame. We want to move into whatever new opportunities you have for us this year. We believe the best is yet to come. And we want to move into it with open hands and open hearts. So we thank you for it. It's in your name we pray. Amen.